Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this kickoff event for the Year of the Eucharist. I'm pleased to announce our guest speaker for the evening. She is a Catholic composer and singer-songwriter from the Indianapolis area who desires to glorify the Lord and serve His church through her ministry. Her prayerful music brings the listeners to an encounter with Jesus Christ, truly present in the Eucharist. Francesca and I met at a workshop over a year ago, and I was just amazed how her message and her love for the Lord exudes from her. We've had a wonderful day with her today. She spent the morning with our school children and the afternoon with our middle school students and then with our staff this afternoon. So I know you're going to enjoy her message tonight. So I'll turn it over to Francesca.
Thank you. Hi. Good evening, everyone. We're going to get started with the prayer to the Holy Spirit. This is word for word of St. Augustine. So I know it's in your worship aids. You might not know this, but if you can, let's go ahead and sight read it together. One more time, really reflecting on these words. Ready? Amen. That was so cool to hear that. Oh my goodness. I found this prayer for the first time on my mother-in-law's fridge. She's actually here tonight. And it's her favorite prayer. And she wanted to memorize it. And as she went off to work, I wrote that. And I've only sung it by myself. I've sung it with students. I've never heard it sung by so many of you. And that was a very powerful moment for me. So thank you for singing that. It was very special. So I'm honored to be here tonight. I want to share a little bit of my story as well as some scripture references about our love for the Holy Eucharist. And then together we are going to have a holy hour together as we adore our Lord in song. So very honored to be here. I come from Indianapolis. I come from a family of musicians. My father used to play guitar at Mass, and it was always my dream to play at Mass with my dad. I'd always been writing songs for school to memorize things for tests, and my mom sat me down when I was 15, and we were doing word-for-word psalm settings at my parish, and we were chanting these psalms, and my mom said, "I bet you could write one of these." I said, "Mom, I write songs. I don't write psalms." But she said, I think you can, and I want to see if you can do this. So the psalm was Psalm 107, "Give thanks to the Lord, his love is everlasting." And my mom said, "Let me sit next to you at our piano." So our piano is very similar to this one at home. My mom sat right next to me. And she said, "I'm going to read this over you, over your hands. We're just going to pray it together. Give thanks to the Lord, his love is everlasting." She says, "Close your eyes." She's like, "What do you hear?" "Give thanks to the Lord, his love is everlasting." And I'm like, "I hear the fan." That's all I can hear. She said, "I really want you to pray." And my mom sat right next to me. She said it again, "Give thanks to the Lord, his love is everlasting. Give thanks to the Lord, his love is everlasting." And as she starts speaking this, I start to hear the cadence. "Give thanks to the Lord. His love is everlasting." And I start crying. And my mom said, "What do you hear?" And I said, "I hear this." From your heart.
Give thanks to the Lord. His love is everlasting.
Very good. You sound so good. This parish really sings. That sounds awesome. So that's what we did. I presented it to our music directors, and we asked them if our family could sing this psalm setting this weekend, and they said, "You can, but we need it in sheet music form. Can you get us the sheet music?" And I said, "I don't know how to do that." So he handed me a paper and pen with all the staff paper, and I tried to write it down, but it looked really sloppy. So I found this website, and I started notating my sheet music, and we did it for the first time with my parish. And to hear all of you sing this, I made eye contact with my mom when you all came in on the psalm, and we just broke down. And I started going to all of the masses, and other cantors and other accompanists were playing the psalm. And I sat in different spots each time to hear, was this too jumpy? Was this too high? This didn't work for this cantor. So I started taking notes. And I really enjoyed writing psalms every week. And after that, I went to college. And I had this thing where we had a coffee shop on campus. So I liked to get coffee, and I would take my iced coffee on my walk to the Newman Center. And I called them coffee dates with Jesus. And I was typically done with my coffee by the time I got to the chapel. And I started having time with Jesus in adoration, which as a musician, Eucharistic adoration was very intimidating to me because I don't like silence. My in-laws are here. They know I like to talk. Silence is so hard for me, but I fell in love with the silence. I started to bring my homework with me to adoration. I don't know if that's allowed, Father, but I started to bring my homework with me because I felt so much peace in the adoration chapel. That's where I found my home. Later on, I was asked by my pastor if I would be the music director for my home parish. And I told Monsignor, "No, I'm not qualified. I'm a music educator. I'm a teacher. I don't have a degree in liturgy. I don't have a degree in theology. I'm not equipped for this. He said, I want you to pray about this because I really feel like you're called here. And I said, I'm going to pray about it, Monsignor, but God says no. So I went to the Adoration Chapel because this was my home. And I'm sitting there, and over the course of a week, I start feeling this pull to come back home and to be the music director at St. Barnabas. So that's what I did. I knocked on Monsignor's door, and I said, Monsignor, I've been praying about this. And God said, yes. And he said, I know. So I served there for 3 years, and I didn't really know what I was doing. I was a volunteer my whole life there, always doing weddings and funerals and masses. So I really felt weird to be paid for something that I had been volunteering with my whole life. But truly, I started every rehearsal in Eucharistic adoration. And I knew that it would cut into my rehearsal time, but I started it with the kids. I started a children's choir, and we started every single rehearsal in Eucharistic adoration. I had a front row seat to Jesus. The kids were behind me, and we sang God's praises with me and 40 kids in this little chapel, and it was so holy. So I did this Eucharistic adoration night because I experienced this every Wednesday at 2:45 with these kids in Eucharistic adoration. I wanted to put on a Eucharistic adoration night for my parish, and I knew that the kids would bring their parents and their grandparents, and we could fill the church because the kids were singing at Eucharistic adoration. And so I'm setting up for this event. I'm setting up the candles, and this woman comes up to me, and she sits, like she's standing right here at the base of the stairs. And she says, can I talk to you? And I said, sure. And she said, what is this? What is this night? I'm not Catholic. I don't know what Eucharistic adoration is. What are we doing here? And I said, well, the priest is going to come down the aisle with the servers, and the kids are going to be singing with me. We're going to have moments of silence. We're going to be singing together. We're going to have Eucharistic adoration. We are going to adore our Lord. And she said, I don't think this is for me. I think I'm going to go home. I'll drop my kid off, and I'll come back in an hour. And I said, I encourage you to stay. If you can, if you have 1 hour, please stay with us and pray. And I was really surprised that she stayed. And so the night was so great. The kids were amazing. They were so great. The kids sang their hearts out for Jesus, and it was one of my favorite nights at my parish. And after the event, she comes up to me, and she said, can I have a word with you? And I said, here it is. Had a really hard week. She said, I need to talk to you in your office. So I go in my office, and she just embraces me for a long time, like one of those like really big hugs. And she pulls me aside, and she has her hands on my shoulders, and she looks me straight in the eyes. And she said, that's really him. That's really Jesus, isn't it? I said, it's really him. She said, how do I become Catholic? And she and her husband went through RCIA, and they are some of the most devout Catholics that I know. Jesus will change your life. He's changed mine. And so after that job, I discerned my music in 2020. I said, this is my year. I'm quitting my job. We're going to do music in other parishes. 2020 was a very different year for me. Very different year. All of my events were canceled. I felt like a failure. I left my home parish. I left my kids behind. I was broken, and I started experiencing infertility with my husband. And for the first time in my life, with us not being able to have kids, I hit writer's block. I was not able to write lyrics at all. And so I started an instrumental piano channel called Keys of Peace, where I wrote a song every day, and then I did the instrumental hymns. I found these hymns in my hymnal, and I just set them to music. I couldn't even sing. I was so sad about the world. I was so sad I couldn't have kids, but I just played one song every day, and then I found the Latin hymns, and I fell in love with those, the Salve Regina, Tantum Ergo, O Salutaris, and I went to my Google, and I searched well-known Latin prayers, and I found this prayer called the Anima Christi, which I had never heard of before, but it has been said by so many saints centuries old. It's a beautiful prayer, and I looked at the translation, and it's, Soul of Christ, sanctify me. body of Christ saved me, and I'm sitting in my basement at my old house. I just started crying. I hadn't been to Mass in so long because churches were closed. I hadn't received Jesus in months. And to read this prayer alone in my house, I knew Jesus was with me. And so I set this to music. I heard this cello part automatically. It was like, na, 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 na. Just spoke to me. I set it to music, and I want to sing it with you right now. I know it's not in the order of our program, but I want to sing it together. This is the Anima Christi. And I've never done this with people and a choir, but I'm really excited to sing it with you today. It's the song right after the Eucharistic exposition. This is the Anima Christi.
Sanctify me. Body of Christ, save me. Blood of Christ, inebriate me. Water from the side of Christ, wash me.
Sing with me, everyone. Ready? Choir, you are amazing. Can we give them a round of applause? This choir? Yes! Amazing. All right, so even though I hit writer's block, even though I wasn't able to write lyrics, when I presented that to Jesus, he said, I'll give you the words. So that's what I've been doing. I've been setting the Psalms to music. I went back to the Psalms that I've been writing. I've been sharing those, and I'm so grateful to have my mother-in-law here because she sends me so many prayers to set to music so other people can memorize them. So I want to give her a lot of credit for what I'm doing, and my husband is amazing, and he's not here, but he's my whole world. He's the sweetest man, and he is a music producer, so he records all of my music. He's a videographer. He does everything, and I would not be the person I am without him, but I have him right beside me, and I have Jesus right beside me. And if you're feeling broken, if you're feeling anxious, I invite you to come home. This is where you will find your peace. And even further than that, I've been writing more music. I wrote this song with my husband, And what I love about this is we put, I'm on this one right here, the Sacrament Divine. We put Saint Prayers as the verses. So this is for, I wrote this song for the Eucharistic Revival. There was a songwriting contest, which I was really excited to do, and I never submitted this one, but the chorus are all different titles of Jesus in the Holy Eucharist, and the verses are all saint quotes of their love of Jesus in the Holy Eucharist. I want to teach it to you tonight, and I hope that this helps you dive deeper into the love of Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. Sacrament divine, body of Christ, Lamb of God, God's living sacrifice, right before our eyes, in the sacred mystery. With me, Sacrament Divine.
Sacrament Divine, body of Christ, Lamb of God, God's living sacrifice, right before.
We are going to do that song during Eucharistic Adoration. I just wanted to give you a sneak peek so you will at least sing the chorus with me. That is beautiful. All right, friends, I want to show some more scripture references of the Holy Eucharist before Eucharistic Adoration to really show you that it is in here. So, I think a lot of us think that the Eucharist is only mentioned in the Bible during where Jesus instituted the Holy Eucharist at the Last Supper. But God has been preparing us for this blessed sacrament for centuries, even before Jesus was brought into the world. So starting in the Old Testament, I have a couple of scripture references here, and I'm excited to share these with you. It starts all the way back in Genesis. Genesis 22. God tested Abraham, and Isaac said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" And Abraham said, "God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering." Moving forward to Exodus, to deliver the Israelites out of Egypt, God commands Moses to tell his people, "Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, they shall take every man a lamb according to their fathers' houses, a lamb for a household. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male. They shall eat the flesh that night with unleavened bread." A couple chapters later, Exodus 16. This was when the Israelites were out of Egypt and they were starving. They said, "Why did God lead us out of this? I'm so hungry." They said, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate bread to the full. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. And when the dew had gone up, there was on the face of the wilderness a fine flake-like thing, like frost on the ground. When the people of Israel saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" And Moses said to them, "It is the bread which the Lord has given you to eat." Fast forward even more, Isaiah 53. It tells of a man who was despised and rejected by men. "Surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows. He was afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter. Although he had done no violence, there was no deceit in his mouth, for he makes himself an offering for sin." Fast forward to where Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Does anyone know what the word Bethlehem means? House of bread. So here, and this is probably my favorite part, John chapter 1. They approach John the Baptist. They say, "Are you Elijah, the prophet?" And he responds, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one whom you do not know, even he who comes after me, the thong of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." The next day, still John chapter 1, he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world." John chapter 1. This was before the wedding feast at Cana. This was before the Last Supper. Fast forwarding just a little bit more, John chapter 6. Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh." And then it is the Last Supper. It doesn't start there. God has been preparing us for this for so long. This is Luke 22, and he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And finally, the road to Emmaus. The very day, two of them were going to the village named Emmaus. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And what I love about this is he starts with scripture and then goes into the Holy Eucharist. And it's a foreshadowing of our liturgy, starting with the liturgy of the word, going into the liturgy of the Eucharist. This is not just a story. This is not just a legend. This is real. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. They call him Wonder Counselor, Healer, Mighty God. They shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Bread from heaven. We are living in history, friends. Bread from heaven. So many of our ancestors never got to experience this bread, the bread of life. And we're here. So tonight we are going to have Eucharistic adoration. And I want this time to be for you. If you want to sing with me I love it. If you don't want to, that's fine. If you want to listen, I want your posture to help you pray. So whether that's sitting the whole time, kneeling the whole time, if you want to get a closer seat, we have kneelers up here for you. Please don't walk up the steps, but if you want to just have a front row seat to Jesus, you're welcome to. This time is yours, and I want to pray with you, and I hope that it helps you fall in love with Jesus, because this is home. This is the closest thing I know towards heaven. And look at these gates. They even look like heaven. So great. So we're going to move into Eucharistic adoration, and I hope that it blesses you. And I hope that you fall deeply in love with our Lord, because he is after your heart. Thank you so much. O salutaris hostia, quae celi pandis hostiu, bella premunt hostilia, da robe fer auxilia. Amen.
sacrifice right before our eyes in this sacred mystery. Jesus, in this Eucharist. Quell the fear. For a word Thank you. sing to Jesus. Is the scepter, is the throne.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Let us kneel and worship as we join our voices in song.
Tantum ergo sacramentu, veneremur cernu.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you gave us the Eucharist as the memorial of your suffering and death. May our worship of this sacrament of your body and blood help us to experience the salvation you've won for us and the peace of the kingdom, where you live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Blessed be God. Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be his most sacred heart. Blessed be his most precious blood. Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary, most holy. Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception. Blessed be her glorious assumption. Blessed be the name of Mary, virgin and mother. Blessed be Joseph, her most chaste spouse. Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Francesca, on behalf of us, thank you so much for coming tonight and kicking off our year of the Eucharist. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Father.
We truly appreciate it. And since we're kicking off the year of the Eucharist, turn to the back of your worship aid and let's say that prayer, okay? I think it's a good idea. Heavenly Father, rekindle our love for Jesus Christ, present in the Eucharist, and let our joy draw others to the Lord's Supper. May all that we do be nourished by the Eucharist. Make us holy and lifelong disciples.
Send us forth to evangelize, sacrifice, and serve with the renewed spirit of self-giving. Amen.